There's so much that I don't see, but I see you, but I see you. And there's so much that I don't know, but I know you, but I know you. And there's so much that I don't understand, but I have seen your goodness, and it's just enough that I
This started with an idea. Somehow, if we were given the opportunity, we could become more. If given the place and the time, we could build a nation where everyone could become more. We prayed for favor. We believed that out of many, we could become one. Though America was never simple, our nation did not give in or give up. We crawled, strived for dreams and freedoms we believed in, fought to hold hands as we learned to stand on our own. We are brothers and sisters. Our dreams are not dimmed by our tears. We have stumbled, but will not fall. It began with the idea that beliefs should not be dictated. Freedom was to be shared. Worship was the right of the individual, not the responsibility of the government. All of these things were self-evident. We knew it in our hearts. They were inalienable for everyone, endowed by our Creator, God-given. On this day, we remember our freedom, and we thank the God who provided it. May God bless America.
Church, stand with us as we sing the national anthem this morning. If you feel led, the words will be up here. Sing along.
Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe. And now to the Word of God. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy Word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
Right. Well, good morning and welcome to our July the 4th service. Today we celebrate, very rarely we get to do this, but we're celebrating today. We're celebrating on the 4th of July, so we're excited about that. You know, as we talk about independence, we need to be grateful, as we have already alluded to the very fact that men and women died, that we might have this freedom, and that it was that, of course, that the government should not be over God's affairs. But God should be over the government's affairs. Somebody say amen. And so today, you know, when we talk about separation of church and state, when we allude to that fact, what we are alluding to is we are alluding to this. We are alluding to the government should have absolutely no control over a religious choice, a religious affiliation, or worship whatsoever. However, we do need some more. We need less of government in the church, and we need a lot more of the church in the government. Somebody say amen again, right? And so today, I just say this to you. If you're glad today for independence, that you have been delivered from the slavery of oppression, say amen. Amen. All right, now let's get to where the rubber really meets the road on this. Our independence today can be taken from us as far as a country goes. It's happened. And it's kind of happening here right now. A lot of your freedoms are being taken away, but can I remind you of something? Our Bible says this, that we shall know the truth and the truth shall make us free. Ladies and gentlemen, today, no matter what happens in your government, no matter what happens in your country, and by the way, I pray for our government and I love our country. I am thankful to God for it. But I still believe this, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And so today, as we celebrate the 4th of July, let's be part of the solution, not part of the problem. But let's be reminded of this, the greatest freedom that you have is not freedom from the oppression of the King of England, it's freedom from the slavery of sin. And that came not by way of many people getting together and fighting, that came by way of one man, one Savior, one God becoming flesh, and dwelling among us, living 33 and a half sinless years, dying on a cross, shedding his blood willfully for the sins of the world, being buried, and ladies and gentlemen, 3 days later, he got up. He got up. And so today, together, we can say, thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm grateful today for our visitors that are here today. Thank y'all so much for being here. Mark and Barbara, good to have y'all today. So glad that y'all are with us. Benny, introduce your daughter that's with us today, all the way from Texas. Yeah, what's her name? Hold her up so we can see her. I know, I mean, ain't no good if we can't. She's got her arm up. Ain't she pretty? Yes. So pretty and so embarrassed right now, all right? But here's the great thing about it. At least she's better looking than you are, Benny, all right? So we're grateful for that. All right, so let's do this right now. Other visitors, if I hadn't had a chance to meet you, I hope I get to before the service is over. Thank you for being with us today. We got a lot of people that are traveling, so be in prayer for them that God will bring them back safely to us. Our deacon of the month today is, of course, Robert Solomonic and Tammy. Robert and Tammy, if you'll lift your hand up over there. All right, and that's their good-looking, almost good-looking son, Grant, over there with them. And we're grateful for them. They have great leadership qualities, and they have been exerting those, you know, here in our church over the last few months. And we're grateful for Robert. We're grateful for Tammy. Of course, Jeff Dinkins is back here, and Jeff has a constant physical struggle. And I do want us to pray this morning that God would give him a special strength and a special healing. We still believe that God heals bodies. We still believe that God is the great physician. And so let's be in prayer for Jeff. Jan, we pray for you as well. And we know that y'all absorb this together. And so you are in our prayers constantly. Our missionaries, of course, are Will and Rebel Hill in Japan. And so let's be in prayer for them today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And let's join together. And let's just ask Jesus, of course, to meet with us. And to bless us specifically today in this area. That he would remind us of how great it is to be independent of sin itself. Aren't you glad today you don't have to fear death, hell, the grave? You don't have to fear sin. You don't have to fear any of it because Jesus has conquered it all. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. And with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, you're so good to us, and we're grateful. And so, Lord, on this Independence Day, Lord, we first of all, but not foremost, thank you for the independence that we have as a country. Lord, we still have great freedoms. I know we've lost a lot, but we still have a lot. So, Lord, help us to focus on what we still have. God, help us to come together through prayer and through your Spirit to try to regain some of these freedoms back for our country. Lord, most of all today, we just thank you so much for Jesus. Lord, thank you so much that you've given us independence, that no matter what happens in any country, Lord, there is a country which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God, and we look forward to that country. We know it's coming, and Lord, we look forward to it. We thank you for providing that for us. Thank you for that hope. Lord, I do pray that you would be with the Hills in Japan. God, I pray that you would be with Will and his family. Lord, I ask you, Lord, today that you would give them a special strength. God, a special influence, a special favor with the people of Japan. Lord, I pray that you would use him in a mighty way. Lord, I thank you for my friend Jeff. And God, I just pray that you would touch him today. God, I know it's a struggle, Lord, for him to get here. And Lord, he loves you so much. He's here as much as he possibly can. And Lord, I just pray that today, Lord, that you would encourage him. God, as a church family, we just want to love him today. And Lord, we want to pray for him and Jan. God, I pray that you'd bless them, bless their family. And Lord, we'd be derelict to our duty in prayer if we didn't ask you to heal him. So God, today we know that the effectual, fervent prayers of men and women avail much. And so Lord, today we pray, we band together and we pray. Lord, we ask you for your will to be done. But Lord, we ask you for healing. You said we have not because we ask not. So Lord, we ask today that you would touch him, that you would heal him. God, thank you for Robert and for Tammy and for Grant. Lord, the blessing that all three of them have been. God, they have all three touched our lives in so many ways. And Lord, so many people are unaware of this. But God, they have just been such an encouragement, Lord, in D Group. And Lord, just their influence. Lord, Grant helping out around here at the church. And Lord, I know that it goes unnoticed some here, but Lord, you see every bit of it. So Lord, I thank you for their service. Thank you for their leadership. And God, today I pray that you would bless them. Lord, bless our church today. Thank you for our visitors, our regular attenders, our members. God, I pray that today you'd inhabit the praises of your people. And Lord, we ask it, of course, in the name of Jesus and all God's people on this July the 4th said, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Church. Can you hear me? Is this thing on? Yes, it's on. Can you hear me? Nope. Yes? Good? Okay. All right. Today's reading of Scripture comes from the book of Matthew. We're going to be looking at chapter 1, verses 1 through 17. Now, before I get into the reading, I do have a couple of things that I want to mention about this passage. In this passage, Matthew is actually detailing the genealogy of Jesus Christ, how he is connected all the way back to David and to Abraham. Now, here in America, really in the West in general, when it comes to genealogies and lineages and things like that, it's not a major significance here. We do have an interest in our ancestry, our family tree. That's why people do the 23andMe or Ancestry.com, but it's not a major part of our identity. That was very, very different when it came to the Israelites. Some of the major benefits of being able to have passages like this are, when it comes to this, typically we tend to skip through them or read over them. But two major benefits that we get and receive from having a genealogy like this in the book of Matthew as Christians is, well, one, Matthew is actually detailing for us something that shows us the benefit, or excuse me, the fulfillment of a prophecy. You see, the Messiah was supposed to come through the line of David, spanning through the tribe of Judah. And if we didn't have the detail like his genealogy, we wouldn't be able to have confidence in Christ as our Messiah. And more specifically, if his genealogy didn't stem through Judah, then he isn't the Messiah, and we don't have hope in him. But because we have passages like this, we can have confidence in that. Another thing that we receive from being able to have a passage like that, and the benefit that we have as Christians, is we get a firsthand glimpse of the sovereignty of God in action. You see, God is about the redemption of his people, whether it's in the Old Testament or in the New Testament. And we see many people in this genealogy whose stories are broken, whose decisions they've made are very imperfect. And so we see how God can use imperfect people to bring about the perfect Messiah. How God can use broken situations to bring about his plan of salvation and redemption and restoration. So as we read this, I want you to pay attention to some of the names that are mentioned. And if you are familiar with these people and with Old Testament history, it'll become very clear to you why they're in there. If you've never heard of some of these names, I recommend you go back into the Old Testament, look at their story, see it, and see how God uses them to be able to bring about the Messiah, and let it be an encouragement to you. Because, I mean, if you're like me, we've all made mistakes. We probably all had times in our lives where we may think, God could not use me, God couldn't do anything with me. But this is an encouragement because it lets us see that his hand is still able to use our lives no matter how broken they are if we're willing to yield to him like many of these people did. So, in light of that, let's begin. Verse 1 says, "The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begot Isaac, Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot Judah and his brothers. Judah begot Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez begot Hezron, and Hezron begot Ram. Ram begot Amminadab, and Amminadab begot Nahshon. Nahshon begot Salmon, Salmon begot Boaz by Rahab. Boaz begot Obed by Ruth. Obed begot Jesse, and Jesse begot David the king. David the king begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon begot Rehoboam, and Rehoboam begot Abijah. Abijah begot Asa, and Asa begot Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat begot Joram, and Joram begot Uzziah. Uzziah begot Jotham, Jotham begot Ahaz, and Ahaz begot Hezekiah. Hezekiah begot Manasseh, Manasseh begot Amon, and Amon begot Josiah. Josiah begot Jeconiah and his brothers about the time they were carried away to Babylon. And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconiah begot Shealtiel, and Shealtiel begot Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel begot Abiud, and Abiud begot Eliakim, and Eliakim begot Azor. Azor begot Zadok, and Zadok begot Achim. Achim begot Eliad, and Eliad begot Eleazar. Eleazar begot Mathan, and Mathan begot Jacob. Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations. From David until the captivity in Babylon are 14 generations, and from the captivity in Babylon until Christ are 14 generations. This is the word of God, church. Please remain standing as we worship him together in song.
Sing, great is your faithfulness, church.
Great. Remember your people, remember.
Thank you so much. Zach, if you will, if you'll grab that side, I'm going to grab this side, and we're just going to go forward, all right? Man, that's so much easier than many hands make light work. Thank you for your hands there, Zach. All right, turn your Bibles, if you will, today to Ruth chapter 4. Ruth chapter 4, we are in our final installment of our journey in Ruth. I hope this has been as exciting for you as it has been for me, just following the bloodline, following just the orchestration of Jesus Christ, or of God through Boaz and Ruth to bring about the birth eventually, as Meshach was talking about, of Jesus Christ. We're in Ruth again, chapter 4, Ruth chapter 4. Just want to say this, John, good to see you, man. I've been praying for you, and it's so good to see you and your family here today. And we are blessed today to have you, man. I know that you've been through a tough time, and I just want you to know we've been praying for you and Jennifer, and thank you all so much for being here today, and we'll continue to pray for you. All right, we're in Ruth chapter 4. Ruth chapter 4. You know, sometimes the parts of the Bible, as Brother Meshach brought out so clearly just a few minutes ago, sometimes the parts of the Bible we tend to skip over include some of the most important information and some of the most important parts in all of Scripture. Now, of course, as you know, there is nothing in Scripture that appears in print by accident, including the genealogies of the Bible. All Scripture, we need to be reminded, 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture. You know, today, probably when Meshach was reading that Scripture, you're probably thinking, you know, what am I supposed to get out of this? And hopefully, as we work through it, hopefully you will get something out of it, because we need to be reminded regularly that all Scripture, not some Scripture, not most of Scripture, not 99.9% of Scripture, all 66 books, all of it is given by inspiration of God. Inspiration just simply means this. It means God breathed it. God breathed it. When our Bible says in Hebrews 4:12, it says that the Word of God is quick. In other words, it's alive. The Word of God is quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. Be reminded of this. The same breath that breathed into Adam, his life, breathes into the Word of God, its life. The Word of God is alive. And because it's alive, because Adam was alive, and because Eve was alive, they could reproduce life. And here's what the Bible does. The Bible, because it's alive, God breathed into the Bible His life, and that life, and that, ladies and gentlemen, is passed down to us through the Bible, through the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, because it is given by inspiration. In other words, God breathed it. And so today, even as we're reading those genealogies, and it might have been that you were sitting there, you're thinking, man, it's kind of boring, these genealogies. And if that's the case, you're going to be kind of bored with our text even today, because that's what we're going to be looking at, is we're going to be looking at the genealogies here that close out the book of Ruth. But this morning, the genealogies of Matthew 1 were read by Meshach, and as you will see today, these names carry huge weights of significance. The genealogies, at first glance, seemingly offer very little devotional perspective, but I do insist to you today and this morning that much can be learned from the family trees of Scripture. Much like the verses from Matthew 1, the verses I'm about to read in Ruth 1 seem less than exciting at first glance. In other words, you're not going to be sitting on the edge of your seat, you know, you're not going to be waiting with bated breath. These aren't the kind of words that do that until you know what these words represent. So if you listen along and stay with me for just a few minutes, you just might change your mind in the next few minutes as to the significant role that these verses that we're about to read play in the part of history's redemption story. Now, to bring us all up to speed, I'm not going to go through the entire book of Ruth as I normally do. Today, hopefully, you're up to speed. But here's what we do know. Boaz and Ruth are now married. And as we saw last week, they have a son. His name is Obed. We read about that a while ago in Matthew chapter 1. Obed means servant. Obed also means worshiper. And so Obed represents the worship and the servanthood, you know, there in the family tree. Obed carries the name, of course, as you remember. Remember, Boaz is the kinsman redeemer. And so remember, as he marries Ruth, Obed is going to carry the names of Elimelech, more specifically, the name of Mahlon, who was Ruth's husband, now deceased. And so Ruth the Moabitess has now married Boaz the Jew from the tribe of Judah, and they together, through the orchestration of God, have produced a son. His name is Obed. That's where we're at today. So let's look at these verses, verses 18 through 22. Would you read them with me? Now this is the genealogy of Perez. Perez begat Hezron. Hezron begat Ram. Ram begat Amminadab. Amminadab begat Nahshon. Nahshon begat Salmon. Salmon begat Boaz. And Boaz begat Obed. Obed begot Jesse, and as we read even in Matthew earlier, Jesse begot David. Five outstanding characteristics. emerge from this book, as we read these last verses and as we read this genealogy, there are five characteristics that emerge from this book that punctuate the essence of the book of Ruth. First of all, Ruth is a book of covenant. Ruth is a book of covenant. As we go back and as we look at everything that has happened over these past few months that we've been looking at this book, the book of Ruth is in direct line with Genesis chapter 12. Do you remember what happened in Genesis 12? Genesis 12 is where we're first introduced to Abraham, and not only that, but we are introduced to what's become known as the Abrahamic covenant. Now remember, this is not Abraham's covenant, this is God's covenant. As you will recall, as you work through the repetitions of this covenant throughout the book of Genesis to the patriarchs, we realize that this is God's covenant that he is making, not with Abraham. God is making this covenant with himself. It's an unconditional covenant. Hebrews tells us this, when he could swear by no greater, God swore by himself. And so God makes it an unconditional covenant with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12 that Israel, his descendants, would become a great nation that would be a blessing to all the world, especially one descendant in particular out of the tribe of Judah, born in Bethlehem, raised in Nazareth, crucified at Golgotha. And that man's name is none other than Jesus Christ himself. So when we read the genealogies, they remind us of God's covenant with the patriarchs, with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then confirm that what God said he would do, he did. How many are glad today, faithful is he that calls you who also will do it? One of the greatest attributes that God has, and I don't even know how to calibrate God's attributes. They're infinite in their every characteristic, and so I can't even begin to calibrate. However, for me personally, my life verse is, faithful is he that calls you, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24, who also will do it. One thing that I am grateful for is the fact that God is faithful even when I'm not. God is true even when I'm not. God loves me even when I don't love him. And so the great thing about God for me is his faithfulness and his truthfulness. The thing about truth is this, that faith is this. Faith is the belief that God tells the truth. God always tells the truth. And so as we're reading this book, what we understand is we understand that this is God at work in the book of Ruth through Boaz and Ruth and Obed. What we are seeing is we are seeing God continuing to keep his covenant because it is unconditional. What if the Abrahamic covenant had been conditional? What if it was conditional on Abraham's behavior? Well, it would have been blown a long time ago. The unconditional nature of the Abrahamic covenant rests in God himself, that he is saying to Abraham, Abraham, you're going to mess up. Abraham, if I put this in your hands, you'll mess it up. So I'm taking it all on me. It's an unconditional covenant. I will keep it even when you're out lying, even when you're out deceiving, even when you're out getting ahead of me, even when you're sinning. I'm going to keep it because I'm sinless and because I'm faithful. And Abraham, I'm making you a promise. Through your descendants, there'll be a land, there'll be a seed, and there will be a blessing. And I will keep that. By the way, how many are glad today that God does the same thing with your salvation? The great thing about salvation is this. God doesn't say it's conditional, John, on your behavior. It's conditional, John, on your consistency. It's conditional, John, on your continuity. No, he doesn't say that. He said it's conditional, or actually it's not conditional, on anything that you're doing, John. It's an unconditional covenant that I'm making with myself that when I save you, I'm going to keep the salvation. And so today, the blessing of being a Christian and the blessing or part of the blessing of being a believer is this. It's that when you put your faith and your trust in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, Jesus is the one keeping it, not you. If it was up to me to keep it, I'd be lost and lost and lost. But it's because of the blood of Jesus and the promise that he made that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So Paul says, I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he and he alone is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I can't keep it. I'm a sinner saved by the grace of God. As we've talked about today, your grace is enough. You say, well, it's grace plus. No, it's not grace plus. It's grace enough. Today, I am saved by the glorious grace of Jesus. And ladies and gentlemen, today I am kept by that same grace. And everyone, yes, well, go ahead. That's worth crapping about. I am kept by that grace. And so today, as we're looking at this book of Ruth and as we're closing it out, we're being reminded that God made an unconditional covenant with Abraham, making him a promise. Abraham, this promise I am making, this covenant that I'm making, I'm not making it with you. You stand over there. I'm making it with myself. I myself am going to keep it. And ladies and gentlemen, today, he is still keeping it. And as we get here in the book of Ruth, what we're seeing is we're seeing that God's covenant that he made with these patriarchs, he is keeping, and he's going to continue keeping, and it's reminding us that whatever God says he's going to do, he is going to do, and he's going to keep doing it. As far as the land goes, as far as the seed goes, they belong specifically to Israel. But let's focus on just this thing. Remember, he said land, seed, and blessing. He said, Abraham, I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to give you a land from the river of Egypt all the way to the Euphrates. I'm going to give you a land. I'm also going to give you a seed. Look at the stars. Look at the sand. That's how many descendants that you are going to have. But then he says this. He says, I'm going to make your people a blessing. And by the way, the Jewish people have been a blessing to the entire world, collectively. However, there's one specific blessing that we cannot deny, and that is the blessing that the world has through this person named Jesus. It's not just the Abrahamic covenant, though. There's a covenant that's coming later, after the book of Ruth. 2 Samuel chapter 7. You remember David? He wanted to build the temple. And he was so disappointed because David had been a man of war. And for whatever several reasons, God says, David, you're not going to build the temple. Remember, at that time, it was just a tabernacle. And there's a glorious temple that's coming for Israel. But David says, I so want to build it. God, I love you so much, and I so want to build this temple for you. And God says, well, you know, David, I appreciate that, and I'm paraphrasing. However, that's not for you. That's for Solomon, your son. He'll build the temple. But then God makes this promise to David. He said, it's an extension of the Abrahamic covenant. And this extension promised David that the Messiah would come from him. Now, in Ruth and Boaz, in their story, we're not there yet because David's not born yet. However, God, in his sovereignty, he is keeping the Abrahamic covenant he made before Ruth and Boaz, and he already understands the covenant he's going to make with David, a descendant that's not even born yet. It's going to come through this bloodline. And so Ruth is a book of covenant. It's a book of reminder that God, when God says, I'm going to do something, he's going to do something, and he does it, and he does it better than anybody else can do it. Matter of fact, he does things nobody else can even begin to do. So it's a book of covenant. Number two, though, it's also a book of contrast. The book of Ruth is set during the time, and some of this will be review, but it's set during the time of the judges. And you remember kind of the mantra? Do you remember kind of the epitome of what was going on at that particular time? Our Bible tells us very specifically this. It was a time where everyone was doing that which was right in their own eyes. In other words, it was moral anarchy. They had turned their backs on God, and they had turned their faces toward whatever that pleased them. They had become hedonistic. They were the kind of people, you know, they were just looking for something else to indulge in, to please them. Instant gratification, temporary gratification, but not godliness. And so every man is doing that which is right in his own eyes. But then we meet a man right in the middle of this. Right in the middle of this narrative, right in the middle of the disturbance between God and man. And what we see is Boaz, a man who our Bible indicates to us was a man who operated in contrast to the majority of the rest of the people. When the Bible says every man was doing that which is right in his own eyes, it is referring to the majority of the people. Most of the people in Israel, God's people, most of them were doing what was right in their eyes, not what was right in God's eyes. Most of them were looking through their own personal lens instead of through the lens of Scripture that they had available at that time and God's Word and God's prophet. And so here is Boaz, and Boaz says, you know what? I'm going to operate in contrast to what everybody else is doing. Boaz bypassed the moral anarchy of his environment, and instead what he does is he embraces the glory and the morality of God himself. Now, this is so relevant to where we live today. Even in the church, most people that sit in church don't think they're doing that which is right in their own eyes, but most people that are sitting in churches are doing what's right in their own eyes. I'm beginning a series next week, and it's the essence of it, and I haven't really come up with the theme or the name of it yet, but next week I'm starting a three-part series on the 11th, on the 18th, and on the 25th. Setting us up for Gary Habermas, who will be here on the 1st of August. But the essence of the series is simply this: find your place. It grieves me as a pastor as I look around our church a lot of times and we're asking for volunteers and people say, I will sit in a pew on Sunday morning, but I will not get involved in anything. And I've told you so many times before, it ought to be that when somebody comes to you and says, where do you go to church? You say, I go to Peace Haven Baptist Church. The secondary question is this. Now, what do you do at Peace Haven Baptist Church? There's a lot of people that can't answer that question. They can answer where they go, but they can't answer what they do. And ladies and gentlemen, doing does not save you, but we are called. We are the workmanship of Christ. And in being in that workmanship, there's something we need to be doing. And around here, I think a lot of, and not just here, but in churches all over the place, people are struggling to find their place. And so over the next 3 weeks, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to help you to find your place. Now, I know some of you right now, you're looking at me saying, Pastor John, I don't want to find my place. I don't really care to find my place. And that's a problem. It's a problem because God has something for everyone. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. We're created intentionally with a purpose to fulfill people that we are supposed to reach. And I'll specify that over the next 3 weeks. However, right now, the first thing you have to do is just say, I want a heart for God. I want a heart for God. And we're going to use David as our template. He had a heart for God. He was the man after God's own heart. Then he had gifts, he had passions, and he had a story. And that's going to be our GPS as we work through. It's gifts, it's passion, it's story. You have gifts, you should have a passion. Something awakens your soul. What is it that awakens your soul? That's your passion. And then what is your story? Because everybody in here has a story. I know there's people in this room right now, your hearts are breaking in two. Maybe this past week something has happened that has just ripped your heart out. And as I look around the congregation, there are people who I know have gone through horrors. But we need to remember our story. Our story has two parts. Number one, it has blessings. And number two, it has breakings. And that will make you what you are. Today, your blessings and your breakings are going to make you what you are. That's your story. And God takes that story and God uses it. Now, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I'll just preach the whole series right now and forget this other part of Ruth. But, you know, I just want us to be reminded of something today. God has a place and a purpose and a people for you. He has a place, He has a purpose, and He has a people for you. You were designed, you were created for that very purpose. So just keep that in mind as we're working through this, that we understand this. God says to David, He says, David, you're not gonna build that temple, but out of you is going to come the Messiah. Out of you is going to come the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Boaz here, he doesn't know anything about that. All Boaz knows is that God's worth standing for, and God is worth serving, and that God is worth standing in a place even of contrast to the rest of the world. And so Boaz does what each of us should be doing. And that is finding our place, standing for our God, and allowing our God to shine through us the light of His glorious gospel. Do you remember David is a lot like Boaz as I'm thinking through this right now. And what I mean by that is this. Boaz shows up, and Boaz is talking about God when nobody else is. Do you remember his great-great-grandson? David? Or I guess it would be his great-grandson, David. Do you remember when he showed up in the Valley of Elah? Do you remember that this is God's army, God's people? And to our chagrin, and to the detriment of the entire country, everybody's talking about Goliath. Nobody's talking about God. And I feel like that our church today, not necessarily Peace Haven, but I feel like our church today, I think we do more talking about the enemy than we do about the Savior. I think we're doing a whole lot more talking about the Goliaths of our life, and we're doing a lot less talking about the God of our life. And so as Boaz shows up, nobody's talking about God. Everybody's doing that which is right in their own eyes. And then Boaz shows up and Boaz says, the Lord be with you. The Lord bless you. David shows up And I believe it's nine times, if I remember. I must go back and count. I believe nine times David mentions God. Nobody else mentions God until Saul finally says, "The Lord be with you." And that's really an insincere statement, because if Saul really believed that the Lord could be with somebody, he'd have been there down there fighting Goliath himself. And so let's be reminded today that we are in a place of contrast. God has made us a peculiar people. We are a different people. We're brand new creations. Old things passed away. We have a brand new nature. We've been declared the righteousness of God Himself. And we have been placed here for this reason, to live in contrast to everything that's going on out there that is anti-godly. That's why we are here. That's what Boaz teaches us. That's what David is going to teach us over the next few weeks. But you'll discover that if you speak about God and the truth of Scripture out in the world, you will find yourself in contrast to the cultural norm. I hope you've already discovered that. You will shine in contrast to the darkness of this society. This immoral environment and ungodly atmosphere will take immediate notice of you. You will stand in that kind of contrast. Talk about God out loud somewhere. Talk about the goodness of God somewhere. Talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ somewhere in a public environment, and watch how people will stop and they will take notice of you. It might be hatred, it might be love, it might just be interest, but you will get attention. And you will be in contrast to what everybody else is talking about. You'll cause a stir, but as God's ambassador, you can be like Martin Luther and say, "I can do no other." And that ought to be the passion of our heart. It's not that we're it's not that we're thinking casually, you know, "I might do this." It's this. It's that because I'm a believer, and because I'm saved, and because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, because of His sacrifice, because of His unconditional love, because He is keeping me, I can do no other. I can talk about no other. You say, "I can't talk about it." It ought to be, "I can't do anything but talk about it." Because it's the greatest news. You say, "Well, I don't know how they're going to respond." It doesn't matter how they respond. What matters is, how are we responding? How am I responding to the gospel? What am I doing with the gospel that Jesus has given me? It's the most precious thing. It's the most cherished thing that I have. And yet I want to hide it. And I want to act like it hasn't changed my life. You say, "Well, people out there, they just don't know how to accept it." They need it. And you are the conduit for it. Jesus has placed us here. He said, "As long as I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. But now you are the light of the world. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Right now, ladies and gentlemen, we, the church, are the hope of this world. And we are silent about it, and it's time that we stop being so sheepish about it. It's time that we lose our timidity, and it's time that we gain some courage, and that we go out, and we're like Boaz and say, "I don't care what everybody else is doing. I'm going to say, blessed be God. He saved my soul." Somebody say amen. And so today, let's look at this book and let's understand there's a man in this book that has given us a shining example. His name is Boaz, and he says, "Hey, I don't care what everybody else is doing. Everybody else might be doing what's right in their eyes, but I'm going to do what's right in God's eyes." And that ain't, I'm not saying it's easy. I've been pastoring this church for 11 years. Before that, I pastored another church for several years, another church for several years. I've been pastoring for a long time, and even before that, I was a youth pastor, an associate pastor. I've done it all. And yet, even at 51 years old, sometimes it's still tough. Sometimes it's still tough to talk about Jesus in a dark environment. Because in my heart and in my mind, I do know I'm going to get rejected for the most part. Just like Jesus. They hated Him, they're going to hate me. However, there's something inside of me that says, "John, you can do no other." Whether it's hard or not, sometimes I'm Peter by the fire. Sometimes I'm Peter by the fire. I don't want to talk about it. Don't want to talk about it. And that's a horrible thing, not for just a pastor, but for a believer himself or herself. It's like, what do you mean you don't want to talk about it? There's nothing else to talk about. Now, I don't mean that literally, but there's nothing more important to talk about. And so let's be people of contrast. Hey, this is a book of covenant. God's going to do what He says He's going to do, and He's going to keep doing it. Number two, this is a book of contrast. Boaz says, "I'm going to be different." And God takes him and uses him, puts him in the lineage of Jesus Christ Himself. This is also a book of connection. In verse 22 of chapter 4 of the book of Ruth, it serves as a conjunction that connects David and Samuel to Israel's history. David being the king, of course, Samuel being the prophet. But Ruth literally sets the stage for the Old Testament kingdom era when people would turn away from God and would choose Saul as their king. But as you know, God will bring his choice to the throne after Saul's failure. A man after God's own heart, as we've already talked about. And of course, that man is David. The significance of the book of Ruth as a book of connection is that it is the only book. It is the only book. The only book in the Old Testament that offers proof that David was a descendant of Judah. It is the only book that directly connects David to the tribe of Judah or as a descendant of Judah. And that is an important fact since Jacob prophesied that the scepter of recognized kingship in Israel would begin and end with the tribe of Judah. Remember Genesis 49:10? I don't know if I have that. Do I have Genesis 49:10? The scepter, this is Jacob. As Jacob is speaking to his son shortly before he dies, he brings all his sons in and he starts talking about it. It begins with Reuben, his firstborn, and Reuben, you're my firstborn, and you're unstable as water. Reuben didn't get a real good report from his father, but Judah was really a bad person. We'll talk about that in just a minute. Judah was not a good person originally. However, God, for whatever reason. By the way, before we get critical of Judah being chosen in this capacity, let's be reminded that God chose you, and you didn't get a real good report either. And God chose me, and I didn't get a good report either. Can we agree on that? And so as we look at God choosing Judah for this purpose, what does he choose Judah for? The scepter, in other words, the king's scepter, shall not depart from Judah. Now think about that. Way back, Jacob, being led by God, prophesies that the scepter, the king's scepter in Israel, ultimately Judah, would not depart out of Judah's hand. That's an important fact. That's an important fact. That royal endowment began with a man named David. Remember, Saul was not of the tribe of Judah. Saul was of the tribe of Benjamin. Saul was what the people wanted. Saul is what the people wanted, and so God said, if that's what you want, I'll give it to you. But he's of the wrong choice, he's of the wrong tribe, he's of the wrong heart. And Saul failed. And so God brings David to the scene. David is God's choice. He's the right tribe, right heart, right choice. And so there is David. And David begins this. Remember, Jacob prophesied that the scepter of recognized kingship in Israel would begin and end with the tribe of Judah. And again, that royal endowment began with none other than David. And it ends with none other than Jesus Christ himself, as we read in Matthew 1. That's why I had Meshach to read that this morning. It's because if you were paying very careful attention, you remember Matthew is written to the Jews. Now, if you go to Luke chapter 3, Luke chapter 3 gives us another genealogy. It's on Mary's side of the family. And it doesn't run through Solomon. It runs through another son of David, Nathan. And it goes all the way back. Remember, the theme of the book of Luke is that Jesus Christ is the Son of Man. And so Luke writes and he traces Mary's lineage back through Nathan all the way to David and then back to Adam. But Matthew does something different. Matthew is writing to the Jews, and the Jews began with Abraham. And so what Matthew does is Matthew is tracing Joseph, the stepfather, his lineage, all the way back to Solomon, to David, and then back to Abraham. And so that is what's going on here. What's happening here is God is proving through the pen of Matthew that David came from Abraham, and more specifically, from Judah. Ruth is a book of covenant. Ruth is a book of contrast. It's a book of connection. It connects the genealogy together. And then it's a book of comfort. In verse 18 of chapter 4, go back and read it again with me. This is the genealogy of Perez. Perez begat Hezron. Do you know who Perez is? We read about him in Matthew 1 as well. Do you remember the story? Because I told it to you a couple weeks ago, so I'm not going to go back through the whole thing. But remember, Perez is the son, one of the sons, one of the twins. Perez, as it's in Old King James, Perez is one of the sons that came from Judah and his daughter-in-law, who was acting as a prostitute unbeknownst to him. She dupes him into having a relationship one night with her, and from that relationship came a pregnancy, and from that pregnancy came two sons, one of which is Perez. Now, you say, Pastor John, why would you tell us that story? Why would you tell us that story? Well, it's because of this. It's because God is including, as we're going to see here in just a moment, God is including in the genealogy some names that we would think shouldn't really be there. Judah's one of them. But here's the thing. When we get to Matthew 1, did you notice there are five? This is unheard of. This is unique. Because in genealogies, and ladies, don't be upset. I'm not a misogynist, but I'm just telling you the truth, okay? Ladies were not included in genealogies. The man's name was carried through genealogies. And so when you get to Matthew chapter 1, God does something through Matthew's pen and in the act of inspiration. Remember, everything God does has a purpose. He does it with intentionality. So God does something very unique that you won't find in normal Jewish genealogy. He includes the names of five women. Five women. And four out of the five, I just have to say, represent somewhat of a motley bunch. There's one in there that actually seemed to have, well, for sure, lived a good godly life. But as you look at the others, there's some problems. Let me give it to you. Matthew chapter 1, look at verse 3. Judah, remember Judah and Tamar, what a horrible thing happened there. And by the way, Judah was responsible too. Beget Perez or Phares. And by Zerah, which was the other twin, by Tamar. Now you say, Pastor John, why are you telling us that? Well, because here's Tamar being included. It just ought to encourage you to know that God, even though Tamar had played the part of a prostitute, and even though Tamar had lied, and Tamar had deceived, and Tamar had done this horrible thing with her father-in-law, even though she did that, God wanted to include her name in the genealogy. I think as a point of grace, just letting us know, in spite of the mess that you've made, I'm making an unconditional covenant. It's not conditional on how you behave. It's only because of me. And so Tamar, here's what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to put you in the genealogy of Jesus in spite of what you've done. How you get to Matthew chapter 1, verse 5. Meshach read it a minute ago. Salmon beget Boaz by Rahab. There's Rahab. What is Rahab? She didn't play the part of a prostitute. Ladies and gentlemen, she was a prostitute. She didn't play the part of a prostitute one night so that she could become a mother. She was a prostitute by trade, a prostitute by choice. And yet, what does God do? God puts her in the lineage of the Messiah and includes her name here, once again, as a point of grace to let us know that even though Rahab was a prostitute, she got her heart right with God, she feared God, she asked for mercy, she asked for grace, she hung the scarlet cord outside of her wall there, and when the walls of Jericho came down, the brothel was still standing of all things. Now that is so counterintuitive to what we would think. Of all things for God to spare when he took Jericho out, the brothel is what's standing. The whorehouse is what's standing. If you weren't listening before, now you are. Every once in a while, one word will get your attention. And that's exactly what it was. It was a whorehouse. And Rahab, she was the madam. And it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense for the walls of Jericho to come down and for the brothel, the bordello, to still be standing. But here's the beauty about God. This ought to comfort you because this is a book of comfort that no matter what you've done, God's grace can go further. No matter how far you've gone down, His grace can reach further. No matter how far you've strayed, His grace can reach further. And that scarlet cord, I don't think it's any accident that it's the same color as the blood of Jesus. As it's hanging out that window, there's Rahab, there's her family that she's gathered, the walls have tumbled, and there she is, in the grace of God, not just alive, but soon to marry Salmon, and in her lineage, a descendant she's going to have is going to be Boaz. Down the line, there's Boaz. And what's Boaz going to be? A godly man. Now, where did he get his godliness from? I believe Rahab and Salmon became godly people. And they handed it down to their family. And so Boaz, he has a godly heritage. At least in Rahab, we know. And so Boaz, he's a product of godliness. He's a product of grace. He's a product of a prostitute turned Old Testament believer. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Listen, if there's something to comfort your heart today, it's in this. It's in that no matter what you've done and where you've been and how far you have strayed away from God, He is still on the front porch. He is still waiting, and He still wants to do something with your life. You're still a person of purpose. And so today, don't be that person that says, well, Pastor John, you don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've done. As far as I know, we don't have any madams in here. And by the way, if we do, God still wants to save you and use you. There may be a madam that's listening out there or somebody that's madam-like. Please understand, this man standing here is a sinner just like you, saved by the grace of God. I'm a product of grace, and you can be a product of grace as well. So today, we look at this book and we understand there is grace to be had by every person that is still breathing. And it doesn't matter where you've been or what you've done. And we see that right there in Matthew 1:5. How about this, though? Boaz beget Obed by Ruth. What is Ruth? Well, there's name number three. Ruth. Ruth is a Moabitess. Ruth was raised in an environment where they offered and sacrificed their children to the false god Chemosh. That's her heritage. That's how she was brought up. That's how she was raised. She's a Moabitess. Of all things, a Moabitess. And now she's been placed in the lineage of Jesus. You got Tamar, played the part of a prostitute. You got Rahab, she was a prostitute. You got Ruth, her environment, her background is horrible and sordid, heathenistic, pagan. And there she is in the lineage of Jesus as a woman being honored by the Holy Spirit of God. Then you get to verse 6. And Jesse begat David. Remember, Boaz, Obed, Jesse. Jesse begat David, the king. David, the king, begot Solomon. And remember, it is Solomon's lineage that we followed all the way in Matthew to Jesus Christ. He begot Solomon, but look who's mentioned. By her who had been the wife of Uriah. Now we got Bathsheba in the mix. Tamar played the part of a prostitute. Rahab, she is a prostitute, was a prostitute. Ruth, a Moabitess, a godless pagan. Bathsheba, the adulteress. And there's God in all of this saying, I can use a Tamar. I can use a Rahab. I can use a Ruth. And I can even use an adulteress. Because I am the God of grace. I am the God that can remove sin and replace it with my very righteousness. Say, Pastor John, is there any good in this story? Well, yeah, everything I've said is good. Say, was there any good? Well, let's go to 16, because you probably know this. And Jacob begot, remember, that's not Jacob the Old Testament. Well, it would be Old Testament, you know, in time, but not Jacob, the son of Isaac. Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Now, I do want to take a moment to say this. Be reminded, Joseph is not Jesus' father. The Holy Spirit of God is Jesus' father. Joseph is the stepfather. But we're following Solomon to his lineage. Remember, we follow it in Luke 3 to Mary's lineage, but we're following this through Solomon. Mary goes through Nathan. But the Bible says that all from the tribe of Judah and from David. But our Bible tells us this. There's Mary. And we know, what do we know about Mary? Well, Mary was none other than the virgin chosen by God as the Jewish to deliver Jesus Christ into this world. Now you say, what are we doing with this, Pastor John? Well, from all this, we learn and we discover that God does not stereotype. God uses people from all walks of life and all kinds of backgrounds. right now in this church. God is using a lot of people that fall more in the categories of verses 3 through 6 and not so much in verse 16. I don't fall in this category. Probably most of you don't fall in this category. Probably most of you are kind of like me. I've spent some time in the pig pens of this life, and by God's grace, He has used me as a vessel for His glory. Years and years ago. Hey, there's a rumor going around that some of y'all were hanging out at Tobacco Road. Years ago. Hanging out at that horrible sodom. I don't have anybody in particular in mind. But hanging out in that, and I'm saying that jokingly. Some of you don't even know what Tobacco Road is. If you don't know where Tobacco Road is, ask Kathy Smith. Kathy Smith can tell you all about it, all right? But I don't have anybody in mind. But some of you have your own Tobacco Road. Some of you have your own places that you used to go and the old pig pens used to hang out in, the old places, the old people. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. That's where you were hanging out. And then God, in His grace, Kathy reaches down and just picks you up. Donnie, God, in His grace, just reaches down and says, you know, they're running from me and they're hanging out in places they shouldn't be hanging out. There's that John Bowman hanging out in places he shouldn't be hanging out with people he shouldn't be hanging out with. Hey, and there's you, many of you. Now, some of you may fall into this verse 16. And if you do, hey, God bless you. God bless you. But most of you, or many of you, you're in verses 3 through 6. And yet God, in His wonderful grace, how about that grace that we have sung about today? In His wonderful grace, He reaches down and He picks these old sinners up. He picks these old sinners up and He positions them in His righteousness and He uses them as a vessel of honor and a vessel of glory. And we don't deserve it, but we sure are grateful for it. We sure are grateful for it. And I'm not even going to talk about Chuck Wally and where he's been. I mean, we're not even going there today. But I heard you say amen, and I know what we're talking about here. That should be a comfort to all of us, that in spite of our past, God ensures our present and our future in His matchless mercy and His amazing grace. God's already forgotten your past. He's already put it behind Him. He's already overruled your accusers. They're overruled. He now gives new life. He gives brand new breath accompanied by a brand new nature. Old things are passed away. All things have become new. We watch similar events unfold in our Wednesday night study of Peter principles. You remember how we talked about Peter when Jesus introduced Himself to Peter? He immediately began speaking of the conforming process and the sanctification process that He wished to exercise within Peter. Our theme verse for that series is this. I give it to you today because you're going to love it. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. If you hadn't heard this before, you're going to like it now. Being confident of this very thing, that He, being God, who has begun a good work in you, will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. So no matter where you've been, what you've done, if you've given yourself over to Christ, here's what's happened. He has begun a good work in you. Ephesians chapter 2, you are His workmanship. Romans chapter 8, you're being conformed to the image of God. And today, ladies and gentlemen, there's nothing any greater than that. Ruth is a book of covenant. It's a book of contrast. It's a book of connection. It's a book of comfort. And lastly, it's a book of Christ. And hopefully you've already picked up on that. The book of Ruth validates the crimson thread that spans from Judah all the way to Jesus Himself. And it aptly protects the integrity of God's promise to the world. You remember Genesis chapter 3, verse 15? You remember the promise that God made all the way back right after the fall? He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, talking to the serpent. I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. Notice her seed is capitalized. Jesus can be traced all the way back. You go to Luke, it's traced all the way back to Adam and Eve, right? But I will put enmity between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, you shall bruise his heel. Now the beauty in that, you know, and we understand this prophecy more in retrospect. Because as we look back, we see enmity between the serpent's seed and the woman's seed. But we also see this. The Bible says, you shall bruise his heel. Just like a snake, you know, there's a primary and a secondary. But just like a snake can bruise the heel of a man. The old serpent and his representatives, they bruised the heel of Jesus. But bruising a heel is one thing. Crushing a head is another. Jesus' wound was temporary. The old serpent's wound is permanent. Satan could wound Jesus, But Jesus could crush the head of the serpent. And Jesus did on the cross 2,000 years ago. Satan bruised his heel, but it was temporary. Here's what Jesus did. And I believe he did this. I'm going to tell you what. When I'm killing a snake, it's not just that. It's a whole lot of this too. I'm making sure that the job is done. And Jesus on the cross, he stomped that foot. Don't you love it in The Passion of the Christ? Whether you like that movie or not, don't you love it when that the metaphor of that snake coming through and Jesus going, boom! Just a representation, a metaphor of what he's about to do. That old serpent's coming up to Calvary, and Jesus is going to say, "It is finished!" And in doing so, he went all over. Ladies and gentlemen, today, please understand this. This is a book of Christ. Ruth points to the very one who is going to come and is going to keep that promise of Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Our Bible says this. Our Bible says that he became flesh and dwelt among us. I don't typically do this. Please don't be offended. Audience out there, don't be offended. I'm about to do something that many of you typically would not do and that I typically don't do. But I'm going to quote from the Message today. The Message is Eugene Peterson's paraphrase. And the reason I'm going to do it is because it kind of puts it in a vernacular that we can understand. John chapter 1, verse 14. Again, this is a paraphrase, but I like it because it says, "The Word, being Jesus, became flesh and blood, and watch this, and moved into the neighborhood." Now again, that's a paraphrase. My English translation that I prefer says, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." However, I read this the other day, and I was actually reading a book, and a guy quoted it, and I thought, you know, I like that paraphrase because it elaborates on what it really means. Jesus came to our neighborhood. As dark, as sinister, as sordid as it was, and is, Jesus left heaven, and he became flesh, which was a vast condescension. But how about this? And then he moved into my neighborhood, and he became my kinsman redeemer. And so today, I just remind you that that's got to be a comfort to all of us, that in spite of our past, God ensures our present. He moved into our neighborhood, he became flesh, and dwelt among us. And as our kinsman redeemer today, he is worthy, he is wealthy in his own righteousness, and he is willing. He's already proven he's willing to die for you, ladies and gentlemen. He is willing to save you. Our main players in this book has been Boaz, Ruth, and Naomi. However, this book, as all books in the Bible, is primarily not about Boaz, not about Ruth, not about Naomi. All the books of the Bible point to one central person. His name is Jesus. You know, as you go back, we talked about Eve. Adam and Eve had, of course, Cain and Abel, several children. They had one in particular. His name is Seth. If you want to know the story of the Bible, this is the story of the Bible. The Bible does not follow any of the children beyond Cain and Abel. The Bible follows one guy. His name is Seth. You follow Seth all the way to Abraham, then to Isaac, then to Jacob, then to Judah. Follow Judah all the way to Rahab and Salmon, all the way to Boaz and Ruth, to Obed, to Jesse, to David. Follow David through Solomon all the way to Matthew 1. Follow David and Nathan all the way through Luke chapter 3. And ladies and gentlemen, that is the story of redemption. And right smack dab in the middle is the book of Ruth, the book of connection. The book that reminds us and even illustrates for us our kinsman redeemer. Boaz serves as an Old Testament type of Jesus. He was willing. He was worthy. He was wealthy. Today we have Jesus. Willing, praise God, he laid down his life. Worthy, he had the attributes that established him to be recognized as the Messiah. He's wealthy. He had his own righteousness that he could give us, which is exactly what we have to go to heaven. And so today, if you're grateful for the righteousness that's been imputed upon you, say amen. Now, some of you today, you may say, "Well, Pastor John, I can't even tell you that that's happened to me. I can't even tell you that that's happened to me." I've asked you to do this before. I'll ask you to do it again today. Would you right now, would you do this right now, okay? Is everybody with me? Everybody with me? Fast forward 1 million years. Are you there? Fast forward 1 million years. Are you there? based on what you know about yourself and about Jesus, where are you? 1 million years. Fast forward, 1 million years. Based on what you know about the Bible, based on what you know about Jesus, and based on what you know about yourself. There are people sitting in this room right now that are 1 million years in their mind ahead, and they know they are not with Jesus. They know about Jesus, but they don't know Jesus. And I say this to you today. Get to know Him today. Not so much that you know Him, but that He knows you. That He knows you. And with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's stand together. Lord, this morning, as we close out this book, we close out with enthusiasm. Lord, Ruth being the book that it is. Lord, it's a book of comfort, though. Lord, of all the things, it's a book of comfort, and it's a book of Christ. Lord, and we know it's a book of connection. We know it's a book of covenant. God, we know, though, it's a book of comfort. Thank you that you're still using sinners. That's all you've ever had to work with. Thank you so much, Lord, that you yourself became flesh and moved into our neighborhood. You became flesh and moved into our world. You came to where we are because we could not come to you. God, we couldn't come to you. When I could not come to where you were, you came to me. And so, God, as we close this book out, Lord, remind us of the kinsman redeemer, not Boaz, although it's a beautiful picture, but Jesus, that we've been bought back from the slavery of sin. And Lord, we've been established as joint heirs with Jesus Christ. But Lord, for that person today that is in their minds 1 million years ahead and not with you, Lord, in a horrible place called hell, hell cast into the lake of fire, Lord, I pray that today, Lord, you would convict their heart. God, you've done everything that you can do. You've loved us. You've died for us. You've made salvation real to us and available to us. Lord, for those that have accepted that, thank you for it. But God, for those that are listening live stream or those right here in the audience, Lord, it may very well be they don't know you as Savior. So, Lord, save them today. God, for the rest of us, God, I pray that we just take a moment. And Lord, that we would just be grateful for our redemption. Lord, as we sing this song, Draw Me Close, God, I pray that would be our prayer today. Lord, understanding the biblical support for this song, if we draw nigh to God, He will draw nigh to us. But Lord, we also understand John 6:44. No man can come unto me, you said, except the Father which sent me draw him. So Lord, draw us close to you. Lord, for that person that's lost, draw them to salvation. Lord, for those of us, Lord, who are struggling and, Lord, maybe just wandering and meandering through this life, God, I pray that you draw us close to your side. Lord, for that teenage boy that's sitting here, that teenage girl that's sitting here, Lord, they're still searching. God, they're still searching. God, I pray that today their search would be over. Lord, for that elderly man, that visitor, Lord, that regular attender, that member, that's still searching. God, I pray that as they search, you'll find them. Lord, we love you so much. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Hey, church, let's just lift this song up. How many of you normally don't sing as loud as you can? Stop your lying. Just get your hand up. All right, today I don't want you to sing as loud as you can, but sing a little louder than you used to, okay? Let's lift this old song up and let's just worship the Lord.
Draw me close to you. Thank you.
Amen. You know, this morning, something that stood out to me was the GPS. I don't know if you guys caught that or not, but God's given us all a GPS, right? We've got the gifts, we have our passions, and we also have stories. And the reason I'm bringing that up is because we have opportunity to be able to use those things that God has given us for His glory. He gives those things to us to glorify Him. And this morning, I want to give you guys an opportunity to do that. There's several people probably in our congregation who have gifts, who have passions for music. And so we want to expand our worship team. And so one of the things that we're going to do is we are going to be holding auditions on August the 2nd. That's Monday evening. So if you're here today and you have a talent to play an instrument, or you love to sing, or you are interested in working with our tech team in the back at the sound booth, whether it's with the audio or whether it's the lighting or with the visual effects, whatever it is, we're looking to expand those things, and you have an opportunity to serve the Lord in that area. So if God's given you a gift or a talent or a passion for any of that, He gives it to you to serve Him, to glorify Him. So the way that we're going to hold those is we actually have these audition forms. They're very simple. It just kind of lets us know what you're interested in jumping in and serving, what regard you're interested to jump in and serve. We have, if you play an instrument, you can kind of indicate what instrument you play, things like that. Now, these forms are on the Welcome Center desk in the back, and there's a basket that's right beside the forms. If you just fill out this audition form, drop it in the basket, we'll contact you, and we'll set up some specific times for auditions on the 2nd. So we would love to have, like I said, a lot of people to fill these forms out. That means if you're interested in the choir, if you're interested in singing on the worship team, all kinds of different opportunities to get involved in our worship ministry in general, fill out one of these forms, drop it in the basket, and we'll contact you between now and August the 2nd. Or you can bring it to Chuck Trivett or myself, and if of course you have questions for us, come see us as well.
That's exciting. I can't wait to see who the Lord brings to our teams that way. So y'all fill those out. All of you with secret talents. Now, what I want to say to this morning is several things. First of all, the most exciting news is that Liz and Jesse have their new little fella here. Hank Timothy Hoots was born last Sunday, I believe. So we have an opportunity to bless this family now with meals. So on the main Facebook Church Peace Haven group page is a list of dates that you can sign up for to help bless them with some meals, or you can see Miss Kimberly Hoots back here, and she can let you know the details there. But we're excited, and congratulations to Liz and Jesse. Also, in next week on July 11th, we'll talk about this a little more in detail, but if you've not signed up for the Love Life Walk, there is a way to do that at the welcome desk, and I won't say any more about that. You just go back there and check that out. Jeffrey, there's a QR code. You can show them that. If you want to do it the QR code way, or you can do a hard copy, actually sign it out. We will sign it out. And we will turn that in for you. Also, the last thing is July 11th, next Sunday, we open up our little kids, pre-K kids. I cannot talk today. Our pre-K kids church will be open next Sunday and July 25th. So mark your calendars for that. And we're opening up the elementary kids church in August.
Say a little bit about the Lifeline Walk.
Lifeline Walk is July 17th, but we're going to talk about it more July 11th next Sunday. We'll expand. Our prayer night is Wednesday of next week and that kind of thing. But you can go ahead and sign up if you're planning to come. It's an RSVP type situation there.
All right. All right. Let me have that microphone here just a second. I'm going to need it. All right. Phil, come here, man. I'm going to get you to dismiss us in prayer. I got a new friend. We went out to eat this past week. Phil's been visiting with us, and he's a blessing. He really is. He has. He and I were talking, and you know, every once in a while you just meet somebody that you're on the same page with, and Phil loves Jesus, and I just want him to dismiss us in prayer. Phil, if you'll do that for us, please.
Let's all bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this word you've brought to us this morning. We pray that you would be with us, be with all those who are sick and suffering in the church, and bring them back to health, if it be thy will. We pray that you would take this word and apply it to our lives and our lives to the advancement of thy kingdom, dear Father. We pray that someone will see something about this word in us this week as we go through our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You are sent.